Hello and welcome to another episode of Learn with Jason. Today on the show, we have Adam Barrett. Adam, thanks so much for hanging out with us today.
Hey, thanks for having me on.
Yeah, I'm super excited. So for those of us who aren't familiar with your work, do you want to give us a little bit of a background on yourself?
Oh, sure. Right now I am a senior JavaScript consultant at Narwhal. And we basically, Narwhal is a consulting company, has this cool product called NX, which is like a dev tools for monorepo development stuff. I've been like a JavaScript guy for a really long time now. I remember the days, being a lad of 35 years old, looking up at my poster of Paul Irish and dreaming of someday being JavaScript famous. Now I'm an old 44-year-old man, and here's my life now, just trying to make that all happen. And so I've been doing consulting for a long time. I've done consulting at pretty large companies that you've heard of, like Apple and Walmart Labs and things, and basically focusing on like front end and how to make front end code better for everyone, how to make it easier, and how to make development teams better at what they do.
Nice. Yeah. And so is that, you said you, when you do that consulting, is that all through Narwhal?
Yeah. Well, actually I just joined Narwhal in February. So I've been doing consulting for about like 6 or 7 years. I was at a company called Batovi before that.
Okay.
But yeah, Narwhal, I've actually only been since February, a fairly new thing. There's actually a whole little story behind that, but we don't have to get into that.
All right. Okay. We can skip right ahead then. So let's talk a little bit about NX in particular. So NX is something that I've heard a little bit about. Like I've seen a couple talks on it. I've seen it in use in a couple repos, but I haven't quite got the elevator pitch down for it. So for someone who's brand new to this, what is NX?
So I would say NX is a suite of tools and basically CLI or terminal tools that sort of enhance the developer experience. It's not really about end user experience. This is about helping developers organize their code, deal with stuff. And it specifically focuses on mono repos. So the idea, not to confuse mono repo with monolith. Mono repo is just about having all your code in one place so that you can sort of avoid a lot of complexity that arises when you sort of like, hey, you want to isolate and split off your packages into individual packages. But if you have them sort of scattered around in different repos, sometimes coordinating things can be tough, and NX really helps you with that. It really like basically gives you, tools to deal with that, but also tools that overcome sort of the problems that you can also get normally with mono repos.
Gotcha.
You want
gotcha.
Me to talk more about that?
I actually think that's a really interesting thing to dig into a little bit, because like I know that so mono repos have this promise. And when you see a mono repo, it's kind of nice because you can see like, all right, I'm going to this repo, there's a README at the root, and then I see like a packages folder or something. And in that packages folder, there are 1, 2, 50, 100 different packages in there. And each one of them is its own kind of discrete project. It functions completely in isolation. But by keeping them in the same repo, we get the obvious thing, which is all the code is in the same place. What other benefits are there for that?
So like the code in the same place can maybe be a little, dismissive or something. It's like, all the code's in the same place. But I like to illustrate that with sort of this idea that, okay, say you were working on a package and three other packages depended on your package without the mono repo. You're like, I'm going to update my package. You're like, okay, I've made some changes. They're breaking changes. Now I need to go to their repo. You know, if it's managed by another team or something or just whatever, I need to go to this repo. I need to make a PR. I need to like go through their CI, have it done. Then I need to go to the next repo, make sure they have a PR, whatever, blah, blah, put it all through. Whereas when you've got a mono, and you don't do that for all any packages that depend on this package. Whereas if you have a mono repo, you get to do it sort of all in one. You get to be like, I've made the change. I can go into each of the individual packages and update their packages because it's all right here. I have access to it. And it's all one CI process. It's all, if anything fails, I'm going to find out right now that, hey, oh, I missed a package. We had a dependency I wasn't aware of. Their tests are presumably going to fail. And you immediately know like, oh, hey, and I can just add that before pushing this out. You know what I mean?
Gotcha.
Above that, though, I would say that NX kind of goes this extra step. And it says, we're going to focus on application development. So a lot of monorepo tools, they will basically help you with, library development. So you'll have a bunch of individual libraries, and maybe you're like a bunch of different open source projects or something like that. But an application isn't, it's kind of the same thing. It doesn't necessarily need to be on, NPM. It doesn't necessarily need to be that way. And so what NX does is we have this concept, our projects, which is like packages, are split into two things. There's basically apps and libraries. And apps are like the things you run, and libraries are libraries. They're basically consumed by the apps. And all your libraries don't necessarily have to be on NPM or anything. They can just be like, hey, this is just a private library. It's just a way we break out code, share it around other places, and keep things nice and organized and isolated. And so, yeah, that's where I think it the monorepo thing really comes into focus, is that monorepo is going to keep everything in one place. Yes, it's going to make tools so you can run all sorts of things across all the different packages, make sure that you're only changing, if you change one thing, you're only going to run tests for exactly what needed them and not everything, because you don't want to waste time. And then in the end, you want to build applications, and those applications are then going to be deployed somewhere, not necessarily like a package up on NPM.
Nice. Yeah, I think that makes a lot of sense, because I do think one of the things that is difficult is like a lot of the tooling out there is either very, very obviously for websites, like, you're using Webpack or something like that, or the tooling is very, very obviously for libraries. And I like the idea that you're coming at that with the acknowledgement that like these are two separate things, but they have to exist together. If you're a big company, you're going to be shipping your website, which is, that's your application. Maybe you've got a dashboard, you've got some marketing pages, you've got, whatever, your support portal, and those might be three separate applications. And then in the back, you're going to have your component library, you're going to have shared utilities, you'll have your auth library, like all these things that are like discrete packages. And if you're trying to put all of those through one tool, it's going to get weird, because you're either trying to make a library piece of tooling function for apps or vice versa. And yeah, so like I can see that, because like I really love, for example, using I think Rollup or Microbundle is really good for libraries, but Webpack is kind of what, or like Parcel is what you would lean on for an application. And if you see repos that try to like make it all do one, you end up with these very kind of like complex and confusing thing. So I like the idea of considering it at the tooling level. So I'm bringing in, if I'm bringing in NX, you're saying that it's going to consider that for me, so that I don't have to make all of these distinctions and build separate sets of tooling. I just get to say, oh, this one's an app, this one's a library, and NX does the rest.
Yeah. And I mean, and NX does sort of try and stay neutral, at least in the more recent years. And so like, bundlers like Rollup and Micro, whatever the one from the Preact person is, they you can still use those with NX. Like they you would just you'd sort of define like, okay, well, my app is going to be bundled with Rollup or whatever, or Webpack probably. And my, these libraries could be bundled with Rollup, and that's okay. Those can be separate. But what NX is going to give you is sort of like one CLI command that's going to be like NX build, and that's going to build it for you or whatever. And you're going to be able to, like in your app, you're going to be able to import, we can show you this later, but you're going to be able to import your library, and you're not going to have to worry about like, does it need to be built first? Does it need to whatever? You're just
Interesting. Okay. Well, on that note, maybe it's easier now that we've kind of got the high level to actually start looking at some code.
Okay.
Does that make sense to you, or is there something else you want to talk through?
Oh, I just want to talk about everything. I just want to talk about how magical this place is. I want to make people drop bloops and stuff. I don't know how to make it happen.
I mean, the chat's all about it. You call for boops, you're going to get some boops. Let's switch over to pairing. There's a question in the chat about NX handling publishing. Nikki, I don't know why that didn't work. It's supposed to work. Let me. Woo. Oh, you might have fired that right code. as we were switching scenes. I think I ate your sound effect. Sorry about that. So everyone, go make sure you follow Adam on Twitter. And don't forget, we have live captioning for this show and every show at lwj.dev/live. The captioning is provided, as always, by White Coat Captioning. Thank you so much to them for being here. And that is made possible through the generous sponsorships of Netlify, Fauna, Sanity, and Auth0, who all chip in to make this show more accessible to more people, which we very much appreciate. Pilo, thank you so much for the sub. Okay, so now here we are. I'm at nx.dev. Ryan, thank you. Oh, here we go. Oh, we started a hype train. Look at you go. Ben, thank you.
One thing I actually forgot that maybe I should have gotten into before we sort of jumped into this is that, yes, NX is definitely, this is a product that was specifically made for large scale teams doing lots of big stuff, doing, you know, with many teams working on the same stuff at the same time. But I was going to show today too how it's actually still pretty cool, even if you're kind of like on a small team or just maybe even by yourself, and you just want to develop something that isn't like, you know, the next Google or a giant, you know, marketing engine with many different websites. It's still actually pretty cool to kind of like use because of all the stuff it kind of gives you right out of the box.
That's great news because it's just you and me today.
Sweet.
You and me in the chat. All right, let's see what we can get done. So I am on the NX website and right. I'm in my terminal here ready to roll. What should I do first?
Well, I mean, if you wanted to like look at docs and stuff, if you're that kind of developer, I would say like, hey, yeah, check out, you know, the docs, get started, go through the
Hold
tutorials.
Up. Look at this. Look at that animation. That is slick.
Oh, this is going to go really well if that's enough to make you smile.
Oh, I'm easy. All right. Okay.
or else we can just like, I can just tell you what to type and we can roll.
No, let's. So what I'd like to do is I want to make sure that we get through enough to show everything. So let's take a look at kind of what our getting started path is here. So if I want to get started, you wanted to do, was it React today?
For the docs, you can definitely look at the React docs. What we're actually going to do is, so NX is really based around plugins. There's actually a ton of plugins. There's both official plugins and community plugins. And we have what's a Next.js plugin. And because Next.js is so cool with their static site builds and their Jamstack builds, you know, that cool hybrid thing, we're going to use their like static export just to show like how static sites can be done really cool in a very neat way with. So we're actually going to use the Next.js plugin. But React stuff is pretty easy to go through. Kind of the same idea. There's no real tutorial for what I'm going to give, but I mean, if you were learning, this would be a good way to go through. There's also a bunch of videos and stuff. There's a tutorial link.
I do like that you've provided like a why NX. I feel like one thing that a lot of libraries do is they assume that you know why and they just launch into like type this. So providing a little bit of context around like, why would you make this decision? Why wouldn't you make this decision? What is this going to gain? That lets me make an informed decision instead of kind of just taking a wild guess that maybe this will help me and I got to try it for a while and then, you know, back it out if it's not my tool. I appreciate that. So, props to your docs team for making that happen. For today, you're going to be my docs. So what should I do if I want to set up a repo here? So do I want to create a folder or is NX going to create the folder for me?
NX will create the folder for you. We're going to do like a, you know, a create, you know, are you a Yarn man or an NPX?
I can be either. Let's do NPX today.
All right. Let's do NPX, create NX workspace with dashes, create dash NX workspace. Or we could do, you know, one thing I saw a show a little while ago where it was like, oh, hey, Yarn has this thing that you can just type in. Did you know that NPM has that too? You can do NPM. Init NX dash workspace and it'll do the same thing that Yarn.
Wait, for real?
Yep. I saw that on your show and I was like, hey, they don't know something, but I'm
okay.
Not in the chat,
so. And then I can just give it any name I want?
You can even hit enter and I think it'll ask you for a name, I'm pretty sure.
All right, let's try this out.
And so the important thing is the first thing you're going to be asked to is sort of the monorepo name. And this is kind of an interesting thought because you're going to have apps and libraries in this monorepo.
Right.
So it's kind of like your organization name. It's not really like the name of the app you're about to build. You're going to put an app inside there. This is more like Adam Barrett or something.
You know what I mean? Okay. So this would be like the company.
The Narwhal org. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. I'm going to use a somewhat confusing name in that sense because I want to make sure this is easy for people to find, but I'm going to call this something similar to the episode name. So faster static site workflows.
Now, I'm going to warn you, you might have to type that in a bunch of times.
Well, in that case, I am going to copy it.
Not right now, but I just mean like, so when you do imports, you're going to import from your org name, at org name slash
and then library. Oh, I understand. Okay, so let's I'm going to bail on that. Let's try again.
Bail on
we'll
that.
We'll do a shorter one. And instead, I'll call it like
this
NX
is why I
demo.
Brought it up, because you don't just want to make this org name willy-nilly.
I got you. No, that makes sense. So I'll call it NX demo. That seems okay.
That sounds awesome.
And then we were going to do next.
Yeah. So yeah, you can see next would be the best one here. There's a bunch of different ones you can choose. Node apps, React, Angular. But next is sort of the plugin we're going to use. And now it's just saying, okay, we're going to put your first application in there. And I don't know, you could do that. You could do, I called mine blog just because it was like, I'm going to make a blog first or what, however you want to do it. But, and if it's cool, yeah, we could just do something simple like a blog.
Yeah,
because we're not really showing off Next.js as much as we want to try and show off.
Right. And that totally makes sense. NX. So we'll do
and I
that.
Wonder how confusing it is and how many times I'm going to accidentally say next when I mean NX and NX when I mean next. For here, I like style components, but you can basically choose the styles you like.
We can use style components. I usually just go plain CSS, but that's Oh, what's up, y'all? Code Phobia, thank you for the raid. Welcome, everyone. We are just getting started here. We just ran the npm init nx workspace command. And so all we've done thus far is talk about what nx is, which is a what sounds like a pretty exciting tool for managing monorepos, not just in the traditional sense of like, here's all my code, but in actually conceptually splitting it out between applications like code that runs in the browser or like a Node app or something, and code that works as library. So applications and libraries are actually handled. So we've given our org a name of NX demo. We've created a blog, or we're in the process of creating a blog. And now I have a question. Am I using NX Cloud?
So I want you to say yes to this, and I'll talk about what NX Cloud does is that this kind of runs through the build process maybe. But so NX Cloud is like, so NX is our open source platform. It's available to everybody. Everybody can use it. NX Cloud is like the attempt to sort of monetize on that. You know how every like open source product needs either to be backed by a giant company or have some sort of way to possibly monetize if it's going to survive long term. And so NX Cloud is basically, it's a way to sort of hook up your NX to get even cooler stuff. And right now that involves faster builds and faster, faster CI sort of stuff. And some cool, nice printouts of what just built and what just happened and possibly more stuff in the future too.
Okay.
But yeah, that's
like insights into your.
Yeah. And it's got a very, it's got a good, generous free plan off the start. The main thing with NX Cloud right now, at least, there are more, but is right now NX has this cool thing called computation caching, where basically if you run a test or run a build or something, it's going to sort of cache the output of that. And if, because NX controls your dependency tree, it knows like, hey, the code that was changed, it didn't affect any of this. So I'm not going to build this again. I'm just going to like spit this out. So if you were to run like your tests and then immediately run them again without changing any code that would affect them, it'll just grab from the cache and pass it.
Slick.
Now it'll do that locally, and that makes it like tons faster. But NX Cloud even offers this crazy thing where it'll take those computation caches, put them in the cloud, and then your team can sort of share them. So for example, if I were to run my tests, it'll sort of upload the cache to there, and then
I pull those changes,
new team member, you pull the repo and you run the test, it'll immediately look and go, oh, cache hit. Just pull the cache down and throw that out. So it won't run through the entire build and whatever.
Okay. So, all right. I mean, that's the selling point, right? Is especially, I remember when I worked at IBM, one of the problems that we had is that, a lot of our tests would take 40 minutes to run or, things like that. So it was one of those things that just got prohibitive to the point that we just didn't run the tests until the last possible minute. It was part of our final deployment step, which meant that usually we had a lot of issues and we had to like fix stuff. So knowing that this will cut that time down is that's a big selling point.
Yeah, and like monorepos, this is like a real problem because, you know, if you end up with, you know, a few hundred libraries and several apps, you're going to run into these issues unless you have something to mitigate that, like computation caching and affected, which we can talk about later. Yeah. If you look at some of the notes that just printed out.
Yes.
So there's one that this is just, you know, hey, is this your first time? You could like go check out a thing. There's one saying it's not installed globally. You could install it globally if you want, like install NX so that instead of typing NPX NX every time, you could just do NX.
Oh, I got you.
And then the top one just above that, I think, is sign up for NX Cloud.
I think, it said it was enabled. I can connect. So I need to click this link. Is that right?
Yeah, if that's clickable.
Do I need the dot? Seems like
no,
I wouldn't.
Not the dot.
Okay.
Just the X. And so, yeah, this is basically like claiming your workspace. This is... like
got it.
Now you're gonna have to sign up a new account for this, which, you know, may be bad TV for a little while. I don't know, we'll see how this goes.
Let me pull it off so I can generate a password. And let's see, and so there's a question while I'm doing this. Nikki is asking, how is it priced? Is it based on
you
runtime?
Hackers, you dirty hackers.
That's right, chat.
So the pricing is currently based on basically time saved. So there's, you know, there's this idea that it calculates or build time saved. It calculates like, okay, how long did this take when it was originally run? And like now that it happened in seconds rather than minutes, I'll add those minutes to time saves. And then I think you get something like 500 hours free. And then after that, it starts to cost, I think it's $1 an hour. Time saved, something like that. And that maybe isn't, that isn't necessarily developer hour saved, because if you were, for example, your CI, right? Like if your CI runs this build, it's going to save a lot of time because it'll always be pulling this cache or whatever. And that'll still count as time saved too. But so it's building time save, if that makes sense.
That's a novel model. I don't think I've ever heard that before.
Yeah, me neither. I'm actually not on the NX Cloud team at Narwhal, but I think they do a lot of cool stuff. they're my teammates. It's not a big company. There's only like less than 20 of us, I think. But yeah, they do cool stuff. So I think, yeah, all you need to do, the already connected is in there. The token's been put in for you because of the URL you used. I think all you got to do is hit next.
Okay. And do I need to connect it?
No. That I think will already have been done for you, I think.
Cool. Okay.
Need something else.
5 hours per month free. Okay.
5 hours. I think I said 500. Sorry. I meant five.
Let's see. And if we exceed it, we don't get billed. It just gets turned off.
Yeah.
Okay. So that's also good
too. Yeah. Because you still have your local cache, I think too, that still works. So you're just not saving as much time.
Tony is, in the chat, is asking, was that a private token? Like, is that something that I need to roll now that I've shown it on stream?
No, I think that's it. I think that's that one-time access token, and now it's done.
Got it. Okay.
Because you even put it in the repo and everything. So yeah. No.
It shows up in the repo too.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I think right now, like, you've claimed this space, and I don't think anybody else can use it. I'm pretty sure.
Got it.
And then you can add team members and stuff at this point, but I think setting it up for the first time is done.
Okay, cool.
Okay, so yeah, now I guess we can like look at what we've made. So like I said, we have this concept of there's projects, which are kind of the encompassing thing, and then there's apps and libs.
Oh yeah, so here's that access token. So it's in the repo. This would be, and this doesn't get ignored or anything.
Nope.
Nope.
He says, pretty sure it doesn't.
Okay, so what I am going to do real quick, I forgot to do a git init on this, so it's ignoring all the files, which makes them hard to read.
Hackers, you dirty hackers.
Well, actually, I think NX should have put like a git file in there.
It set up git ignore, but I have my dot file, so like my whole root directory is tracked in git, and then I ignore everything not what I want. So if I don't git init, then this whole directory, like VS Code, just assumes that I don't want to track any of it. This makes it a little easier to read. Well, cool. So this did quite a bit for us. We can see recommended extensions. Fascinating. Look at that go. It,
that's neat.
These are things I didn't even know these were things. Am I going to regret this? Let's see. I'm going to install them.
Yeah. So one of the opinions that I wouldn't say NX, but I guess I would say one of the opinions that our official plugins really hold is TypeScript. And they basically default to TypeScript unless you tell them not to. So there's going to be a lot of TypeScript going on here.
All right.
And so, like I said, you've got apps and libs, these two libraries here. Libs, obviously empty right now. We haven't created one yet, but we can. Apps, you've got the NX plug. And then you've also got just sort of built in for you end-to-end tests. And those are done with Cypress.
Fascinating.
And they just kind of get included so that it's easy to run your end-to-end tests whenever you want. And yeah, this is, if you didn't realize that your end-to-end tests are just a different app that you're running against your first app, now you do.
Yeah. So in here so we've got...
You can actually start this up if you want. So you would run the command from all your commands are going to be from the root project. So you're not going to go into individual apps. You're going to stay at the root of whatever we named our org.
Let me install NX, and it's just called NX. It's not like NX. You've
already got it should already be installed. Actually, it should already be there. It'll be in the package JSON and everything.
So I would run.
You want to do it globally? Sorry.
I figured I'd just get it set up. NX.
Shave off 3 characters every command.
Why not, right? Give it a exactly. Give it a try. Let's get the full experience here. So I've just installed NX 10.3.3, and now there it is. And there's a whole bunch of help.
Yeah. So you can run, in this case, NX serve. And then the name of your app. And so this is like, which app am I going to sort of start? And this is sort of the development server kind of thing. So NX serve next dash blog dot whatever. And this should start up. And so the generator, which came with the Next.js plugin, sort of generated this app. And it just puts in this extra stuff. Ooh, it's all that jazz. Oh, that's good. It puts in this stuff for you that just like is a splash page or whatever.
Okay.
You can see that if you click on there.
I have so many browser windows open, so I have to open each of these separately.
Nothing special here so far. This is just what you've got. We can look at the pages code and we can start changing things.
Yeah. So a couple questions in the chat here and one from me. The first one is from Paul. And he's asking, is it possible to opt for like Flow instead of TypeScript, or is that a built-in?
No, TypeScript. So it's based on the plugin. You basically have these plugins have these things called schematics, which is sort of a concept from the Angular world. Just a short aside, NX sort of first started out as a Angular CLI extension. It was like Angular CLI, which is NG whatever, but better. So it's NX whatever. And then after a few years of sort of building that out and it became a little more generic. It was like, oh, hey, we could do this for like anything. It doesn't necessarily have to stay with Angular. And so then they introduced React. And it's all kind of done through these things called schematics. And schematics are basically, if you think about them as code generators plus code mods together. And so our Next.js plugin provides schematics and builders. And builders are just like things that run stuff. And the schematics are what sort of generate this, and they include the TypeScript and stuff. And TypeScript is also, I think, how NX handles the imports from libraries to apps. So though you can make a library and you can make it JS, and you can make an app and you can make it JS only, I think you're sort of at least a little bit on the outer rim stuck with TypeScript. And I don't know of any plugin that gives you a Flow alternative.
Okay.
Make one. You could make a schematic, you could make a plugin that does that, but I don't know of any that exist right now.
I got you. Cool. And so
that was a long explanation, but I hope that kind of made sense why I had to make it so long. I didn't just want to say no.
but this is interesting though, because my next question was actually going to be like things like Jest and Cypress just kind of showed up here. And so if I wanted to use something else, like I personally really like Jest and Cypress, so I'm happy that these were the defaults. But if we were using something else, we would just not use the Jest schematic, and we would be able to put in something else.
That's right. Yeah. And, okay. And so some of our, you know, some schematics basically call other schematics. So in this case, our Next.js schematic actually calls the Cypress schematic to make the end-to-end test. When it makes an application, it actually calls Jest to throw in Jest tests too.
I gotcha.
So you would end up having to like write your own sort of plugin or your own schematic at least. And you can actually, technically there's a thing called workspace schematics, which are just like, hey, specific to this workspace, we just want this. Like, this isn't like something we want to share with other people. It doesn't have to be bundled into a plugin. We just want our, you know, components or whatever to always be generated like this. We want our libraries to always be generated like this. We want to be able to set up, I don't know, an alternative end-to-end test thing off the top of my head, but we want something with Puppeteer rather than...
Right. Yeah. So, and this... Yeah. This reminds me a little bit, and now granted, take this with a grain of salt because I don't know Angular that well, but it reminds me a little bit of the Angular CLI where... Yeah,
and that's why it does, because originally it was like a drop-in replacement for the Angular CLI
with some extra stuff. Oh, okay.
It's diverged since then, but so it actually does more. And but when you start up an Angular app, for example, using Next, using NX, it'll say... Do you want to use the Angular CLI or the NX CLI? Definitely want to choose the NX CLI. There was even sort of a marketing thing, make Angular CLI faster by just switching it to NX.
Fascinating. Okay.
And that's just, I think, because of the computation caching and stuff. I'm not sure. It's better in every way. I don't know what I'm talking about. Better in every way.
To answer your question, Govinda, this is, as far as I can tell, this is not similar to Gatsby Cloud. Gatsby Cloud is for building Gatsby sites. This is for managing repos, so it's going to be a different use case. You could even use them together, for sure. I think.
Yeah, I don't think there's a Gatsby plugin that I know about, but there might be a community Gatsby plugin. There's definitely not enough, like a Narwhal one.
But sure,
it's a community one.
But so this puts us in good shape. So if we do something like we can just knock this whole thing out, and we'll say, hi chat, and then we can drop all of this out. And let's just get down to, here's our styled page.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so I have this still running, right? So it compiled. So we should see over here. There we go. All right.
Yeah, so. And it'll, because it's the Next app, it'll have like fast refresh and everything like that you're normal to. Because again, this isn't like NX doing anything. That's all just like Next.js giving you this sweet little setup, except let's do something NX-y right now, I guess.
Okay.
Let's what would be the best thing to do? Let's make a library, like a component library. So the command, I guess, to generate, if you can open up another one or whatever.
Yeah, we can.
You don't necessarily have to stop that one, but.
Oh, okay. So yeah, I'll get that one going and we'll just open up a new tab.
Whatever you like. Let's see, what was I going to do? I was going to say we should make a component. So if you do like, cool.
Why does it think I'm in a different 14, 15? You should be in 14. I got to figure out why those defaults get weird on me. Okay, I'm ready.
So to generate a library, we have this sort of generate command. So it would be like NX generate, or you can shorten it to G. And then we're going to do a React component library. So we're going to use this is kind of funny syntax, but there actually is a VS Code GUI if you prefer this sort of thing. But we're going to use the installed already React plugin to make a component. So you'll do @narwhal. /react.
Like
and
that.
And then that's the plugin we're going to use. And we're going to create a component from that. So it'll be colon. I guess we're going to make a lib. Yeah, a lib first, and then we'll add components to it. So
okay.
Yeah, we're making a lib. And I guess we can hit that.
Okay.
And now it should ask, what do you want to call this library? And I think we should just call it components. I don't know. That's kind of a funny name. You'd probably be whatever, but hey, let's just call it components.
Yeah, works for me.
And whichever you like, but I mean, we already went with
CSS. Why not? Chaos. Sure. Chaos.
Yeah, I was gonna say now we're gonna have some crazy bug problem, but it'll be fine.
I can do that again if we want to keep it consistent.
I'm sure it's fine. Well, let's find out.
We'll find
it'll
out.
Be exciting. It'll be exciting if it's fine. And so now, if you look in your directory structure, there should be under your libs. You should now have a components library.
And there it is.
Cool. And so in this, this was generated sort of using. It's got, you know, Babel in there, ESLint, all this stuff that we sort of already pre-decided that you want. And there is this component thing. This is maybe not necessarily, we might want to actually put individual components in this instead.
Sure.
Let's do that. I think, so the command then is, nxg, at narwhal react and then component. And then I think you have to say, I wonder if it'll ask you. If you hit enter, will it ask you what project you want to add that to?
What is the name of the project?
And so the project in this case is components, yeah.
Okay. What name would you like to use?
I guess I never decided what component we were making.
Make a button.
Let's make a button.
Okay.
Yeah, I guess lets you.
I guess we get to choose for each one, right?
Well, yeah. That's intriguing to me too. I almost wonder if I've messed something up.
Export it in the project. Yes, I do want to do that. And now what's happened? So now we have a button. Here's our button. We're importing our styles. We get a styled button. Welcome to button. No, that's all, but that's good. So then out here, it didn't affect this, but
yeah, you could probably even delete those three like components ones, because I don't think we're going to use them. We actually want to just like
that was a very what's his name, Steve Ballmer, like components.
But you don't have to though; it's fine too.
So something just clicked for me. So what just happened is we when we first initialized this, it kind of initialized with our components, but it was also exporting this component here with the export star from components. That was not the button I meant to hit. If we delete this one now, we're cooking with a component library. So I can get rid of, like you said, we'll drop this one out. Yes. Bye.
See, this is why you're so much better at it than I am, because you told everybody what I was thinking, but you actually said it coherently.
Yeah, so this is great. Like, this is great. So we've got we've got like this button. So let's make this button a button. And I will, let's see, styled button, styled div. Why don't we just make this a styled button?
Button.
And then we can click me. Or I guess we could even do like, let's not worry about it. We'll make it one of those.
Leave that for the React tutorial thing.
Yeah.
So now to put that in the app, if you go to like the page, the index page of that app that we were working on, the blog thing or whatever.
Right.
The way you'd import this now is you do import, you know, I think we exported, I don't know if it was the default export or not. I think it's we might not. Even do both. No. Okay. From, and then this is where you would do at your org name, like as if it was like a, yeah.
Just yeah. Like what did we call this? It was NX demo.
And then slash, and then our library name, which in this case happens to just be components.
And interesting. Now so this, it automatically picks up our org name, and then it kind of sets up. So are these the just aliases that NX handles for us?
Yes, and that's kind of the crazy thing about NX that like really it clicks with you when you kind of realize is that it's not actually doing anything magical. All this really did at some point when you set it up, when we generated that
oops,
library.
I broke it.
Well,
let me see if I
was it actually NX demo? Well, you know what? There's a good way
button,
to check.
Export button. Import button. Where should I check?
If we go into workspace.json, which is where all this kind of stuff gets configured, where a lot of this stuff. So that's the app and on the different projects. I think if you go to the very bottom, so these are basically all the different commands you can do for each of your libraries and stuff. On the default project is that. Okay, maybe not the
YAML, YAML, right. YAML, YAML, JSON, JSON.
But yeah, this is where, like, if you had sort of deeply nested libraries that were like in folders and stuff, you could find the library name, because the library name is actually like, if you have it in folders, it'll be dashed. So this would be a good place to find the library name.
Gotcha.
But I thought the org name was on here. I wonder if we got that wrong. But there's also a TypeScript file.
The somewhere. Config?
Maybe. Yeah, I'll open that one up. And so you can see in there, it's got
NX paths. Demo components.
Yeah. And so that should lead to where it goes. And
I wonder if I need to restart because we added that after this was running.
Sure, maybe.
It just may not have picked up that alias for us.
Yeah. I do find sometimes when you change the top level TypeScript, a restart is usually a good idea.
Give it a refresh. There it is.
Huzzah. Ooh,
and just looking beautiful. What a great button.
I think it's got pink by default.
It sure does. It's let's make that readable. Okay. So, I mean, this is great. So now we can, you know, we're in our component library and this is actually really exciting because keep in mind what's happening right now is we are importing from a package that will eventually be published. But I'm making edits in it. So if I make this display block and we'll set it as like margin auto and like a width of, let's say, 300 pixels. All of that's live updating, despite the fact that we're across two separate libraries.
Mm-hmm.
So that's slick.
Yeah, and it makes it a pretty good way to deal with things. But if I might suggest something that's even better, in my opinion.
Oh, no.
Well, it's when I work, I you know, generally we're working on large teams, large apps, large sort of stuff. But even when I'm just doing it by myself, I like to keep things like really isolated and, you know, abstracted away. And okay. So when I'm working on a UI component, I don't actually want to go into the app and like go two levels deep and find my state there and work on the component there. I like to use something like Storybook.
Okay.
And so if you would indulge me, we have Storybook plugin.
Okay.
One thing you can do to sort of like see a list of the plugins that are available too. You can, well, some of them at least, you can do NX list and yeah. And this will sort of give you, so there's it's kind of a long list, but, up at the top, there'll be the ones you have installed already.
Oh, community plugins. Wow. Okay. All right. Let me, yeah. So installed, I have Cypress, Jazz, Splinter.
Currently installed. Yeah.
Okay.
And then
we can also get.
Yeah, these are sort of the official ones because they're made by Narwhal.
There's Storybook for us.
And that's the one I want you to install. And then there's community plugins just below that, which are just what other people make.
Ionic. Let's see, what else do we recognize here? There's a serverless one. That's kind of fun.
Yeah, and NX is not limited to just the front end either. There's,
you know, Nuxt and Vue, if that's your thing. Svelte.
Woo!
Stencil. Awesome. Cool. Yeah, there's all sorts of good stuff in here. Go. Ooh, nice.
Not to say that's my plugin. I had nothing to do with that plugin. I just mean Svelte's my jam.
No, this is great. Okay, so I copied. No, I didn't. I thought I copy-pasted it, and I definitely did not.
So another important thing about NX is that there's one package JSON, and it's at the root of the project. And this is how NX handles all the dependencies and is what enables it to do all the cool stuff it can, like, you know, computation caching affected, all these kind of cool things. So when you install, you right from the root, you just do npm or, you know, yarn or whatever, install. And in this case, we want to npm install at narwhal/storybook.
Oh, so I don't even have to use the NX CLI for this. I can just drop it right in.
Yeah, like this is just normal. Yeah,
okay.
In this case. So while that goes, and then basically what I'm going to do here is I'm going to give a command, and then we're going to struggle our way through writing a story because I always forget the
this is good because I have not done much, if any, Storybook dev. This is going to be great.
I have one up nearby.
Oh, good. I'm
to look at just in case because I always forget. It just changed recently. They had a new version. It's like a much simpler syntax, but I always just forget. how to write stories nowadays. So that's good radio while we wait for this to build.
Oh wait, we can make this. Here we go. Okay. So, so this is pulling everything in, and while we're waiting for that to pull everything in, we can, let's pull this up again and just take a look. So to just kind of reiterate what we've done, because I think that it's kind of interesting to just look at this as we go. What we've done so far is we've run like three commands and written about five lines of JavaScript, and we've been able to set up a monorepo that's got end-to-end testing. We've got a component library that's external, and now we're going to be able to publish this separately. Like we'd be able to just npm publish.
You can. Component. There's actually a publishable flag that you can add when you create it that'll add sort of the stuff that makes it publishable. And you can do it later on too. But honestly, you got to wonder if you want to make it publishable. Like, is this a component library that you want live? And maybe it is, and maybe you want to put your storybook up and stuff. Or maybe this is just internal, and there's no reason for this to be public. But you still want it separated out because, you know, you've got the shared UI team works in this library, and you've got the auth team that works in the auth library, and you've got, you know, just depends on how you want to build stuff.
Right. But we've got... basically three full-blown apps here. We've got our end-to-end testing is an app that will test our site here. Mm-hmm. Our site is, you know, pretty straightforward right now. It's just our index page. But then this index page is able to pull custom components out of our component library. And all of that was done, you know, we've been at this for about 45 minutes now, including a bunch of chit-chat, and we've been able to get this, like, running. To the point where we're editing one library and seeing it live reload in another, and now we're ready to add storybooks. So let's keep going down the rabbit hole. What should I do next?
Okay, so now it's NXG for generate again.
Okay.
And then at narwhal/storybook. And then I believe the command is colon configuration. There might be a short version called config. I'm willing to bet there is, but I just...
Let's find out.
And it probably is going to, okay. So yeah, going to use the React one.
Okay. Cypress, we probably want that.
Yes. Cause I think it's neat.
Default path should have a required property name.
Oh, okay. So I guess it doesn't just let us like, so I guess we're going to have to give it, components there. No, I'm sorry. Just write the word components there, I think.
And is this going to attach it to components?
Yeah. So what this is going to do is this is going to set up Storybook just for our components library. It's going to configure it in there and you can whatever, but it's also going to set up a Storybook sort of on the top level too. So there'll be sort of this, like, everybody can share this configuration for Storybook, and then each individual library can have separate Storybook configurations if they need.
Gotcha.
If that makes sense. And then the Cypress thing is pretty cool because what it's going to add is some Cypress stuff. It's going to add an end-to-end test specifically for components. Mm-hmm. And what you can do with this is it'll basically start Storybook, hit the like iframe version of Storybook, and then you can just like test your components, you know, individually on their individual pages, which is really cool. And hopefully we'll have time to show that.
Yeah, very cool. Okay. All right. So this is, you know, and like for anyone looking at this going like, oh, wow, this is taking a while to install. Maybe, but imagine how long this would take to set up. So I think this is really, really interesting. And look, here's our storybook. So we've got stuff coming in here. And did it pull in? There's our stories. Cool.
And so the only thing we are going to have to do, and we might as well just get started while this is we're going to have to write a story here.
Okay.
So I think by default, what it does is it looks for anything in the lib folder that has whatever .stories.tsx or JS or whatever. And so we need to create a file called button.stories.tsx, I guess.
Button.stories.tsx, like that?
Yeah. Yeah. And that's all configurable too, but Which is just right up in that dot storybook you had there. You can actually set that in the main there to actually go to the main JS in that dot storybook directory you have just above there. Yeah.
Okay.
And you can sort of see this is where that's decided. Oh. You're basically saying, I'm looking for anything that ends with either storybooks, TSX, or MDX. MDX is actually a really cool one, too.
No, MDX, I would maybe today's not the day, but now well, I want to know how that works.
Well,
if you're ready for it.
Let's do that right now. Sure. Yeah.
All right. I'm going to switch it to an MDX because I love MDX.
Of course, we're going to be typing a lot more.
I'm ready.
But so I think what we need to do then for MDX is we need to install the maybe it comes with it. We need to install the docs. Can you go to the very top level? There should be a dot storybook directory in the right there. And look at that main. So the other main, what it basically does is it pulls this in. And I think we need to add a storybook. We can get rid of add-on knobs because knobs is old school. And now we want to add at storybook controls and at storybook docs, if that makes sense. Oh, man, you're great at this. You're great at understanding what I want you to type.
Like that.
Yeah. Okay. But I think we're going to have to install those libraries. I don't think we have them in the package JSON yet. So I think we're going to have to install those. I think.
And I'm in the root of the package.
Yep. Root of like everything, like root of the.
Right. Yes. Page. Root of the whole repo. And I'm installing storybook controls and storybook docs.
Cool. All right. Now, while that builds, let's go back to the end. Oh, what is it not like?
Storybook docs is not in the NPM registry.
Oh, did I get that name wrong? Let me just quickly Google that. I thought it was docs. Good radio, sorry. Storybook docs? Maybe the chat knows.
Is it singular?
Maybe. Sorry about this.
There's an add-on docs?
Oh, it's add-on controls and add-on docs.
Okay. All right, we can fix that.
So it's add-on dash for both of those.
Okay. So let's fix that. Add-on. Add-on. Here we go.
And so, yeah, we can start writing that MDX story now, I guess. So
okay, I'm ready.
Wait for that. So we start with an import usually. Let me just find a version of it so that I'm not making it up as I go. So we want to like import meta and story and canvas, all with capitals, from storybook add-on docs blocks.
Give me just one second. I just realized I'm not muted on this thing. So we're importing, you said I only caught canvas.
Sorry, meta with a capital M. Okay. Canvas with a capital C. And story with a capital S. This is so much typing. I apologize.
No, it's all good.
From at storybook slash add-on doc, add-on dash docs.
Okay.
And then slash blocks, I think it is. Yeah.
So slash block, like slash we're blocks. Digging in.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, and then we can just import our button, I guess, from right next to us, just with a relative import. Man, I hope this works after all this. just be button if we're in the right place, right?
Should be. Let's button. Yeah, it'll work. It's gonna work.
It'll work. Maybe MDX is like, hey, I don't know what's going on. We probably had to. Anyway. And then we do a meta component, and we give it a title and a component prop. So the title is whatever we want, our button.
Button. And component.
Component is where we'll actually pass the button as a prop, yeah.
Okay.
And then we can do a canvas component with a story child.
Okay. story.
And you could keep that text too. Anything you write.
Story child canvas.
Yeah.
Story.
This is brave. Yep. And in the story, it'll have some props. It'll have a name and you can pass it args, but maybe let's not worry about args for right now.
Okay.
Just a name is fine. Anything, I guess. Button or primary is the one that comes by default.
Oh, I got you. Like, yeah.
This is like the various different stories you're going to have about button.
I got you.
And then the child here is a function as a component sort of thing, if you know what I mean. Function, it'll be like a function in the interpolation.
Render props thing,
thank you.
Okay.
And whatever, I guess here's where we would do it. So here's where you would get args in that top of that function. And then you would put the button and, you know, whatever args you were going to pass here. And that's for using things like the controls, which let you like change it in the sandbox. But I think we could just return button.
Okay. So we'll just return button.
And now you can
add. And then down here, I can add whatever I want, right?
Yeah. And above it too. And all around, you can just put those components wherever you like. I even think the imports can go wherever they want too.
Let's try it. Let's see what happens.
Okay. So hopefully this works. And I'm not sure if it will, but because I feel like I missed something important, but I guess we'll find out. Maybe the chat can point it out too. I think this setup to answer in the chat too is set up by Webpack. I'm almost 100% sure because of the Webpack config there.
Yes. Yeah, that seems reasonable to assume. Cool. So,
we would start the storybook by going NX. Storybook, he thinks. Storybook control. Or sorry, components. So we're like basically this? Starting space components. Yeah, I think that doesn't seem right.
Let's see what happens. Nope. Okay. It doesn't like that one. Do I need to do like a serve or a run or something like that?
It is something.
Cannot find module NX Cloud. What? We installed that.
Interesting. Not sure about that one. Cannot find an Narwhal Linux. Maybe try and install that?
Let's see. Did we lose NX Cloud? There it is.
Oh, we're good. We're gold. Let me just find out what the command to start that storybook is.
Okay.
It is... Oh, come on, brain. Oh, it should be NX storybook components, just like I thought.
I'm wondering if maybe... I think what happened was when we ran it last time, it corrupted the node modules, because I just ran another node NPM install, and it seems to be working now.
That seems like a big bug. So we'll have to work that out.
That is one of my least favorite bugs in NPM. And I don't know if it's like with the tooling, if it's with NPM, if it's something else, because, you know, we're now five layers deep in context. But for whatever reason, every once in a while, installing something will corrupt the NPM cache, and then you just have to like reinstall, and all of a sudden everything works. So let's give this a try. And let's see what happens. We have, my goodness. Look at it go. Now this is
docs tab.
Docs.
Just at the top there.
Holy crap. Okay, so this is really cool. I honestly don't know anything about, like just in general, I don't know anything about storybook.
Storybook.
So this is really cool that we can do contextual docs.
Yeah. Pretty awesome. And then you can add like a bunch of different stories for different states and stuff. And like I said, there's this controls idea. Do you want to explore controls for a second, or do you want to move on to something else?
I have, what do you think, chat? You want to learn about storybook, or do you want to learn more about NX? You have 5 seconds to respond. I've got more NX.
NX. Okay, so let's abandon this thing. But let's go to the Cypress part of this, though, which I actually think is pretty cool.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, let's do that.
So it set up a Cypress app for you called end-to-end controls. And if you go there, we just need to add a test for our buttons, basically our buttons component. And we can add the most ridiculous of tests just for fun.
Okay.
Just to show it run. But, oh, so we need to add a directory in this source. Sorry, I didn't realize this didn't come automatically, but we need an integration directory right under source there with fixtures, plugins, all that. Integration.
Okay. And what's the file?
And then the file is whatever we want it to be, but it has to have spec, I think, in it. So we can do button.spec.ts.
Or .ts. That's a good call.
I mean, it probably would work with JS, to be honest. But
So this is different from this.
Interesting, right? Like there's Jest tests, which we could run right now too, by the way. If you just do NX test controls, it'll run all the Jest tests it finds in
components, right?
Components, sorry, yeah. I don't know why I said controls. I got all caught on that before. Presumably these will pass because I don't think they test anything out of the box.
Is an element on the page.
Yeah.
Right? Which works. Good.
Yeah. An interesting thing there is it took 10 seconds, right? If you run it again, it should be even faster, presumably because of the caching that I was talking about before. So boom.
Look at it go.
Just instant. That's just like a small but ridiculous demonstration of that caching thing I was talking about, how once you run something, it'll cache the results until code has changed to make it like need to rerun again.
Right. And so if I do change this, let's say we'll set this up to accept some text, right? So the text would be a string if I'm remembering how TypeScript works, and
fantastic at that.
We'll be able to say, oh boy, here we go. Text equals click me.
Nice.
Here we go. Can I write TypeScript? Find out this week on Learn with Jason.
Apparently you're fine.
Okay, so that should have worked. And so now if I test that again.
10 seconds again or whatever. Because now it's going to actually run the test.
Okay, so 7 seconds. So not as fast. If I rerun it, cached, boom, done. Excellent.
Yeah.
So that's really slick. That's really nice that just works. Okay. So then we need to write our spec for Cypress. Yeah, so we're up here. I've got my button spec.
Holy buckets. Did that just work?
It did work, Tony. It did work. All right. So what happens next?
So in our integration spec, it's basically Cypress. So you write describe and an it. I don't know if you know what I mean when I say that, but
okay,
seems like you do. And yeah, it could be a test or an it, whatever.
Is
and
a then, button. this is okay. Like, so now I'm lost. This is as much as I know.
Okay, so for now, just do cy.get, and then we'll do like. In a string button, and then do just like button. So we're going to look. So what this is going to do is cy.get is going to look for a button element. And so this, if you think about this Cypress test doesn't know anything about React. Apparently it can, but I'm not getting into that. This is just going to be like, I'm looking for a button, and then I'm going to like assert that it exists. So you should do dot should exist. And then a string that says exist. Pass as a function. So,
like this?
Exactly. Oh, and then one thing that I don't know what all the TypeScript trouble is, but...
These, I think...
We can ignore it, maybe, hopefully.
What don't you like? Show me my problems.
It might... Yeah, I don't know, actually. That's interesting, too.
Void is not assignable to parameter... of type string. Oh, I need to do it like this, right?
Oh, yeah. Sorry.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
And same with the it too. I think goes like that. It's like it's a string and then a function. String is the first parameter of it, and then a function is the second parameter.
Okay. Okay.
So I guess we couldn't ignore it. Bazinga.
Okay.
Ignoring the describe squiggly, we actually need to go to the page first. So there's a before each, That you should put a function before in the describe, but before the it. It actually doesn't matter where you put it, but
before each.
Yeah.
And that's just a regular function, right?
Yep. And in there, you can do cy.visit, so cypress.visit. And then this takes a string. And this is the fun part. So we're going to do sort of a string that's like a path going from like root, so slash iframe.html. Sorry.
Just like that?
Iframe.html. And then with a query param, like a question mark, ID equals, and now we need to figure out what the ID of the test of the storybook is. It should say, if you look over in the on the browser, at the top of the URL in the browser, it'll say button --primary. So that's our ID, button --primary.
Like that?
Yeah. Okay. So that should work. That's all I have in my little test at home.
Okay.
I don't know why. I don't know what's going on with TypeScript, why it's mad, but you should be able to go NX end to end, or E to E for short. And
that, like
then,
this?
Components, but not just components. You have to do components dash N E to E, just like, because you're running the app.
Oh, that's that right. Is. That's right.
Yeah. And I think his brain says, is this going to work? So what this is going to do, assuming this works, is it's going to start up Storybook. Oh, it's something that doesn't like it.
Yeah, that's a warning.
It's going to start up Storybook. It's going to start up Cypress. Cypress is going to go to the Storybook page. It's going to run its tests, you know, clicking and doing whatever it needs to do and asserting. And then it's going to display the results in the terminal, essentially.
Opening Cypress. Cool. Here we go.
Opening Cypress. And you can get, and you can watch it, which is pretty cool. And you can also, just like every other test thing, just like the Jest test too, you can watch it in watch mode so that they continually run, which can be nice sometimes. Looks like it passed. And then another cool thing, by default, that recorded a video of it too. Mm-hmm. That's a setting you can set in the end-to-end test itself. But if you go into like your directory structure, so that passed, by the way, which is just pretty
cool.
And if you go into your the root into your directory structure, if you go to slash dist, like not typing here, just looking at there. Yeah. Cypress, and it'll be, yeah, the apps component. There's basically a video of what of that test.
So I got you. So
I got failing for some reason, whatever. And that's all Cypress. That has nothing really to do with NX, but it's just cool. Excuse me. It's just cool that Cypress does that out of the box.
That is really nice that it just does that out of the box. So
yeah, and you can turn that off too if you don't like large video files filling up your disk folder, which I can totally understand. It's literally just like, I think it's a config videos true or videos false.
So, mm-hmm. Yeah, and we can see it run. So yeah, that's
so you could see what went wrong. You could share that with somebody. Blah blah blah. Also, your app has end-to-end tests, which, you know, basically work the same way. These ones would presumably be just for what's in the components library. The app would, of course, do, you know, your happy path or whatever you're going to test.
Right. And now, and so these don't get, do these get, oh, this, so this one got auto set up, which is pretty cool. So it's already got like the visit is set up. It says it should display. So this one is actually going to fail because it doesn't have a.
Right, it doesn't have whatever email and all this stuff. Yeah,
yeah. But so with the default, before I edited things, this would have worked, and now we need to rewrite that. But so if I can rewrite that because we changed the homepage to be what? Hi chat. So let's make it say that. But where's get greeting? Get greeting from support app.
And so, yeah, that's sort of a Cypress thing where you make these functions that are going to do things that you're going to do repetitively. So you could make like a login function or a whatever, you know, so that you don't have to do these things repetitively. Or
so in this particular case, that actually wouldn't work for what we've done. So we have to get the H2, but that means we can drop this out and then I can do the exact same thing, except now I'm going to do next blog NXE2E.
Oh, yeah.
And this should be way faster because we've already installed the Cypress binary, theoretically. So what we should see is it should grab all this for us. It's going to start our app. There it goes.
I guess that kind of also, after this is run, we should probably do the thing about static sites too. We should probably at least run an export once just to show that we can export that to a static site.
Yeah. Let's do it.
Looks like
I screwed something up. It failed because I did the wrong thing. H1 within the element, but H2 never did. I don't believe you.
So what's on that page?
I don't know. Let's go watch the video. Let's go to the tape. Okay. So we get here. There's my H2. Don't you lie to me. What?
Oh, what? Okay.
Ooh, right click the video. Nice.
Oh, and reveal in Finder. Yeah.
That's slick.
I mentioned that before.
Video and then reveal in Finder. That would have been faster. Okay. Nice. Good tip. Thank you. Capital C in chat. That is correct. There we go. Let's do that.
Nice.
Run it one more time. This is going to pass. But this is like, what I love is I would legit never set up tests for like a website. Like I would just be like, I'll just look at it. Right. And so the fact that this is done makes me want to use it, but like the extra time that I would have to set up to like configure this all on my own, no way am I going to take that time. So what I like about this is it's doing something that I love. You may have heard me repeat this ad nauseum, which is it makes the right thing the easy thing. It's taking defaults that we should be setting and making them easier than not doing it. And I think that's a really good takeaway from here. Like this is it's well thought out, and you know, we're seeing the chat is showing appreciation for this. And you can just see like how quickly this sets up good. Like it also just sets up good like repo hygiene. The fact that what we're looking at here is a well structured, you know, it's predictable. We know where things are going to go. We know how to run things. And if we move between teams, if everybody's using this tool, things are going to feel similar. Like, you know, it's still a code base. Like when we start writing code, we're going to have our own opinions. We're going to have our own approaches, but the boilerplate will at least feel familiar. And I think that's nice.
Do you want to do NX blog export?
Or absolutely,
NX?
I do.
Actually, it's NX export and then the name of the blog app.
And we called this next blog NX.
And like, again, NX can't take any credit for this. This is basically Next.js running export, which is just cool.
I broke things. Property text is missing in type. Oh, no, that's fine. So this is good. This is the code doing what it's supposed to do, because what I tried to do was make this required, but it's not required. It is optional. So to do that, I do this.
No, question mark on the after text.
After text.
Yeah.
That's right. So
you
now.
You almost had 100% on your TypeScript.
I know. Ben Elegbodu is going to be so disappointed in me. I retained so little. Okay, so now that I've actually made this optional, I believe it will have stopped yelling at me for that at least. And this, so here's a question: VS Code is yelling at me about this component because it doesn't exist yet. Is that something that I need to configure? Or actually, hold on. ESLint is disabled since its execution has not been approved.
Oh, there was a pop-up earlier that came up that asked you if you wanted to use this. This thing.
Yeah, I want to allow it. Okay, so I solved that one, but now it still doesn't like this component.
In the pages?
Reason. Let's see why it's doing that. Let's go up to the app here, pages here. Why don't you like?
Yeah, why don't you like that? Because if you looked on that import, or sorry, the that TypeScript file that we looked at before, that was there at nx/component. So that's interesting. Maybe you just need to restart TypeScript.
I wonder if I need to turn on like the tslint or something. Do I need to use ts?
I don't remember turning anything on myself though.
I don't know. I have a lot of things installed on VS Code. So let's assume that I've misconfigured it.
If you did like Command Shift P, I think it is, or whatever that thing is, and then just type in restart TypeScript, I think it is. Restart.
Restart TS server.
Yeah, do that one. That'll take a few seconds to restart, but I wonder if that'll make the problem go away. The reason I say that is because I often, when I've changed something in a TypeScript config file, need to restart it to make it like, that tslint is deprecated ESLint thing. That is true. It's going to be a long process though. I wouldn't worry about getting off tslint in a hurry. But yes, technically everything should move to ESLint. But yeah,
that appears,
huzzah,
appears to have fixed it. So let's see, I'm going to close and open it again just in case. And look at it cooperating. Okay. We exported,
and it should be in dist, and then it'll be like the dist folder, the apps, and then whatever we call this.
Exported.
Not next. Oh, exported. Yeah, right there. It'll be right there. And so, yeah, you could just serve that exported directory or pass it up to Netlify or wherever you're going
to
go.
Yeah, we can go to like app Netlify drop, and let's use that tip I just learned. Let's reveal in Finder. So now we've got, is it public?
Exported, actually.
Here's exported. So I'm just going to drop that right in here. Bam! And
I'm
it's uploading.
I'm going to be perfectly honest. I don't know what those other two directories, the .next and the other one, do. But yeah, this works.
But look at that. That is slick. So this is great. I mean, and we could hook this up. Like there's some stuff you can do. So this is a next like static export. Next also has the kind of hybrid mode. So we could hook it up to next on Netlify if we wanted to make that, if we wanted to have like the API routes and the dynamic stuff, preview mode, those sorts of things. But I can just see like, you know, that's a next specific episode. I feel like what we're doing here is very,
for sure.
We're trying to look at how
to
we set these up.
NX can do, yeah. And then,
but yeah, what a fantastic amount of progress that we were able to make in the 80 minutes that we've been working on this. You know, having functional Jest tests, having a storybook with end-to-end tests, having an app importing an external library with live reloading while we dev, and Jest and Cypress end-to-end test. Like that is I would have expected if you had told me that I needed to set up a new like boilerplate for a team and we were going to launch some new project, I would have scoped weeks for what we just did in less than 2 hours. So that is a serious power up.
I think so.
There's a question about NPM publish. There's two questions.
So you don't need to publish the components library if you're just pushing out the app. Like if the app's the only thing important, like it's just importing that from the library locally, like you don't have to worry about that. If you wanted to push the components library, you could. You basically, there's another command to set it up as publishable, and then what that does is when you build it, it adds a package JSON into it basically, or its little build factory, and then lets you like publish that to npm. I actually don't really know how that works.
Here is an article that we'll include in the show notes.
because I've never really had to do it, to be honest, because I'm just concerned with the app usually. But you can do it.
And Madama asking about Nuxt and Vue. There are schematics for that. We were looking at those a minute ago.
Plugins, technically, because plugins have schematics and builders inside them. There is Vue community plugins, at least for Vue and whatever the other one was.
Yeah, how do I find the list of community ones?
The community ones, it was the NX list, kind of lets you show them.
That's right, that's right.
And NX it's probably list on that community page as well, if you're on the website, if you go to the community page too.
So here is, there is a Nuxt and a Vue that'll let you do all of those things. But yeah, so I mean, that's really slick. Like we, I also think one thing that's interesting here is the fact that we can have these isolated libraries without having to publish them. Mm-hmm. That is excellent, because one of the things that I think is really stressful for a lot of teams is like, I want that abstraction of something, you know, I have this, this whole spiel that I'll go on about optimizing for deletion and why we need to create really isolated, really, really clear boundaries between code bases, because, you know, code is fluid. It gets leaky. Things, if you don't force separation, it will eventually turn into soup. And what I like about this is it lets me kind of have my cake and eat it too. I don't need to publish a repo. I don't need to publish a module, which means I don't have to figure out private module hosting. I don't have to figure out how do we do security around that. But I still get that abstraction of building it as a module. And that to me is a huge win, especially for teams that are working on like internal private code bases. Because it, like at IBM, I remember we wrangled a lot of private NPM registries because everybody needed that modularity, but we didn't have a way to make these things installable without having that registry. So,
well, and the easier you make it for people to break out code and to put it somewhere else and like, oh, hey, we repeated this a bunch of things. Let's break that into its own library and put it somewhere else. The more they'll do it. And that's great. You know what I mean? Like, and it's so absolutely easy to just, oh, let's just, hey, we're doing the same thing in these three different libraries. Let's break that into a fourth library and just have them all import that. So easy to do. That's what that it's going to really help clean up a lot of code.
Yeah. Really, really slick stuff.
If you had them in three separate, you know, NPM packages that were all had their separate CI and stuff, that would be a big pain to like just take that little piece of code out and share it amongst the three other ones.
Right. And if I had to set up my, you know, if I'm setting up my own Jest test and Cypress specs and the repo config in my own bundler, like, no way am I going to do that. I'm going to leave it in the app that's already set up. So this is, I can see how this cuts down on copypasta. This cuts down on people taking shortcuts, duplicating code across code bases because they don't want to abstract it out, because it actually is easier to abstract it than to deal with the copy paste and the like maintaining in three separate apps because you didn't want to extract it into a library. That's really, really nice. With that, we're coming to a close here. I think this was wonderful. I feel like we've got some really powerful tools moving forward for ways that we can set up and maintain our own apps and libraries using NX. Where should someone go if they want to take this further? Like, what would you say are our next steps?
Well, I definitely think like go to the nx.dev, the easiest website to remember in the world, nx.dev. And there's links to tutorials, links to other resources. There's blog posts about things. There's a getting started tutorial that you can kind of walk through. Lots of different videos made by different people. There's an Egghead series right now. I can't remember the name of it right now, but that kind of walks you through how to do development with NX. And
is it
lots of different stuff. That's actually not the one I was thinking of, but I guess there's more than
one. No, let's dive in here. Let's find it. Is it the one from Jury?
Yeah, I think so.
Yuri? I don't know what I'm doing to your name. I'm so sorry. Here's a whole playlist on it.
Yeah.
So that's a good one.
Scale React Development with NX. That's the one. Yeah,
cool.
For sure.
All right. We'll also throw this into the show notes. Man, cool. Very cool. So what if people want to follow up with you? Let me drop your Twitter link. Where else should they go?
You know, that's mostly it. I'm kind of the Twitter. That's my jam is Twitter. You can always check out my GitHub. I have a nickname that I go by a bunch of different places. Big AB. So my GitHub is Big AB. But, you know, not much cool goes on there. And also just to you know, be rude and plug myself on something else. I'm also the host of a podcast called Of Dice and Men. The Twitter is @of_dice_and_men_
Okay.
Because it turns out that's not a very, whatever now. Yeah. Or you can go to ofdiceandmen.ca because I'm Canadian.
This one here.
Yeah, that's the one.
Okay.
We basically, it's three guys who talk about board games. It's probably super boring, but it's super fun for me. So
I'm into it. I love stuff like this. I think it's I think it's great. But I say that as somebody who occasionally sets up a camera in my kitchen and makes dinner on YouTube. So
anyway, so those are the best ways to get a hold of me. And yeah, hopefully I'll do something cool like a podcast or something sometime.
Excellent. Well, very cool. So Adam, thank you so much for spending time with us today. Chat, make sure you go follow Adam across all those different platforms. And thank you again to our sponsors. We've had live captioning today by White Coat Captioning. Thank you so much for your help. And that's made possible through the sponsorships of Netlify, Fauna, Sanity, and Auth0, all chipping in to make the show a little more accessible to more people, which we deeply appreciate. Also, while you're here, make sure you go and check out the schedule. We've got some really, really fun stuff coming up. Later this week, David East is returning to the show. We are going to build a multiplayer soundboard. This is going to be pure chaos. It's going to be one to watch live because part of the show is going to be you from home playing sound effects along with everybody else watching live at the same time through the same speaker. It's going to be wild, and I'm probably going to have to mute it after a little bit, but it's going to be super fun. So please come hang out. The more of us there are, the more chaos there will be, and the harder we will all laugh together. Then next week, I've got Cassie Evans coming on. If you haven't seen Cassie's work, it is brilliant. She is an amazing SVG animator, and she's going to teach us how she builds these incredibly complex SVG animations. It's going to be super fun. So make sure you show up for that one as well. And just keep scrolling through because we've got so much fun stuff coming up on the show. Make sure you go check out the schedule, sign up for the Google Calendar so that you get notified. With that, I think we're going to call this one good. Adam, thank you one more time for hanging out with us today.
Thank you.
Chat, stay tuned. We're going to raid. We'll see you next time.